Set me as a seal upon your heart, as a seal upon your arm, for love is strong as death.
Thank you. May I welcome you very warmly to St Bride's to this special evening service. Back in 2019, we held our first ever St Bride's Brides and Grooms service, to which we invited all the wedding couples whom we could still trace who had been married here, whether recently or many decades ago, to come back here for a service of thanksgiving. We were delighted by the response, and it was a wonderful service, but we also recognised from the outset that this theme is not an easy one for everyone. There are those who live with the pain of bereavement, having lost a marriage partner. There are those whose marriages did not stand the test of time, for whatever reason. And there are those who have embraced a solitary life that would not otherwise be of their choosing. We shall do our best to recognise this complexity in the service that follows, so we hope very much that it will speak to you in some way, whatever your circumstances. We begin now with an opening prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, ever faithful in your love for us, we thank you for the gift of human life. We thank you for our relationships and for the joy and fulfillment that they bring. Bless us this day with your love, that in the joys and struggles of our lives together, we may know the unifying touch of your presence. Keep alive within us the fire of your love, that we may kindle flames of goodness within our world and grow in love for one another and for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
A reading from the Gospel according to John, chapter 2, beginning at the first verse. On the third day there was a marriage at Cana in Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus also was invited to the marriage with his disciples. When the wine gave out, The mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "O woman, what have you to do with me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now 6 stone jars were standing there for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to them, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them up to the brim. He said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the steward of the feast." So they took it. When the steward of the feast tasted the water now become wine, and did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the steward of the feast called the bridegroom and said to him, "Every man serves the good wine first, and when men have drunk freely, then the poor wine. But you have kept the good wine until now." This, the first of his signs, Jesus did at Cana in Galilee, and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Scaffolding by Seamus Heaney. Masons, when they start upon a building, are careful to test out the scaffolding, make sure that planks won't slip at busy points, secure all ladders tighten bolted joints. And yet, all this comes down when the job's done, showing off walls of sure and solid stone. So if, my dear, there sometimes seem to be old bridges breaking between you and me, never fear. We may let the scaffolds fall, confident that we have built our wall.
A Dedication to My Wife by T.S. Eliot. To whom I owe the leaping delight that quickens my senses in our waking time, and the rhythm that governs the repose of our sleeping time, the breathing in unison of lovers whose bodies smell of each other, who think the same thoughts without need of speech, and babble the same speech without need of meaning. No peevish winter wind shall chill, no sullen tropic sun shall wither the roses in the rose garden which is ours and ours only. But this dedication is for others to read. These are private words addressed to you in public. In the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. One summer many years ago, we spent a holiday on the Greek island of Rhodes. We had very little money back in those days, so we were staying in a slightly run-down hotel in a rather run-down resort. But it was actually fine, if a little basic. Our hotel room had a balcony, and it was lovely to sit out there in the evening at the end of each day and watch the sun go down, accompanied by a glass or two of Retsina. Now, as it happened, our balcony overlooked a rather shabby Greek dwelling, rather more of a shack than a villa, which had an iron balustrade along one side, supporting the weight of an ancient grapevine, and a small garden with a bit of a vegetable plot. And although I didn't like to pry, that building was so directly in our line of vision that when darkness fell and the lights went on in that little house, it was impossible not to see what was going on inside it each night. And it was always the same. There was a simple wooden table in the centre of the room, at which an elderly man and his wife sat together each night, quietly reading. They didn't move very much. They didn't speak very often. They just sat there together, exuding a kind of contemplative togetherness that, to a person like myself, leading the busy and turbulent life that I did in those days, was quietly mesmerizing. They clearly had very little in the way of material wealth, But seeing them just sitting together, sharing that comfortable, companionable silence, suggested a level of contentment that no amount of material wealth could buy. Because I had the distinct sense that this was not the silence of a couple who long ago ran out of things to say to each other. Rather, this was the silence of a couple who were so comfortable in one another's company that they no longer needed to converse, because companionship alone was enough. I can't help feeling that they were a couple who, to use Seamus Heaney's image, had indeed built their wall. The scaffolding had come down and there it was, and it was a wall that was built to last. I remain very haunted by that glimpse of what was clearly a life that the couple had shared for many, many years. And I was reminded of it again when reflecting on the T.S. Eliot poem that I read for us a few moments ago. Eliot's own marital circumstances, indeed his whole life, were far from straightforward. Indeed, Lyndall Gordon entitled her biography of him The Imperfect Life of T.S. Eliot. His marriage to his first wife, Vivian, was an unmitigated disaster, leading to her psychological disintegration and her eventual death in a private asylum. He eventually found happiness in his second marriage to Valerie Fletcher, a woman 30 years his junior, and it was his relationship with her that inspired the poem that we heard. I wanted to include that poem because I think Eliot describes brilliantly something that I'm sure many will recognise, but which is really very difficult to capture in words. Because he describes a quality of companionship that is so close that it is as if that person has become part of you, and yet that person remains a source of leaping delight. In other words, what he is describing is a relationship that is not only companionable, but profoundly joyful. Human love is a strange and wonderful and perplexing thing. It can have remarkable strength and resilience, although its fragility can also catch us completely by surprise. The most unlikely of relationships can stand the test of time, while the couple whom everyone agrees are absolutely made for each other grow apart and fall apart. Indeed, on the subject of romantic relationships, the singer Joni Mitchell astutely observed, "I've seen some hot, hot blazes come down to smoke and ash." And of course, one of the hardest things to bear is that the deeper one's love, the more devastating will be one's grief when that person is lost to you, whether through death or relationship breakdown, or even through illness such as dementia. And of course, that quality of relationship does not actually have to be marital at all. Our soulmates are not always our marriage partners, and sometimes it may be friendship, simple but deep, that carries that emotional freight for us. Our opening reading from St. John's Gospel may seem a fairly obvious choice for this service because, of course, it is set at a marriage feast. But there's more to it than meets the eye. Jesus very often uses the image of a wedding feast when describing the kingdom of God because of all that it represents in terms of love and joy and celebration and unity, and as a statement of hope in the future. But marriage at its best is also transformative, because love is transformative. The water of our ordinary lives becomes the very finest of wine, as in the parable, as we discover who we truly are and who we can become, knowing what it is to love and to be loved. And that quality of love, that quality of human loving, remarkable though it is but a foretaste of the transforming power of the love of God, the steadfast love that never ceases, the love that truly lasts. Today is an occasion for us to be profoundly thankful for the gift of human love and for the gift of human relationships, whatever form they take, without at the same time denying the costliness that also accompanies a true life of love. But we must also remember that the divine love, of which it can only ever be a foretaste, is what finally awaits us. There's a wonderful prayer of blessing for marriage by the priest and poet John O'Donoghue, who wrote this. As spring unfolds the dream of the earth, may you bring each other's hearts to birth. As the ocean finds calm in view of land, may you love the gaze of each other's mind. As the wind arises free and wild, may nothing negative control your lives. As kindly as moonlight might search the dark, so gentle may you be when light grows scarce. As surprised as the silence that music opens, may your words for each other be touched with reverence. As warmly as the air draws in the light, may you welcome each other's every gift. As elegant as dream absorbing the night, may sleep find you clear of anger and hurt. As twilight harvests all the day's colour, may love bring you home to each other. Amen.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the gift of human love. We thank you for the gift of marriage and family life. We ask your blessing upon those whom we love and upon those upon whose love we depend. O God, the Spirit of truth, help us to be truthful with one another. O God, the Spirit of gentleness, help us to be gentle with one another. O God, who knows what is in our hearts more clearly than we do ourselves, help us to hear one another. O God, lead us in the way of truth and love. We pray for all who are united in marriage and for those preparing for marriage at this time, giving thanks for the love they have found. We pray too for any who find their life together a struggle, for families that are under pressure, for those whose relationships are broken beyond repair, and for all who live with the pain of disappointment, loss, or betrayal. We pray too for those who live with the pain of bereavement, for those mourning the loss of a much-loved life partner. We remember those who are alone for reasons not of their choosing. And we pray for those scarred by past experience, whose wounds make it hard for them to love. God of compassion, giver of love and grace, surround us all with your healing love. Help us to be generous in our loving and magnanimous in our forgiving, that we may shine as your lights in the world and be channels of love and grace to all whose lives we touch. We pray for this Church of St. Bride and for the churches from which we have come. We pray for all who have worshipped here and ministered here faithfully over many centuries. We pray for all who have pledged themselves to one another in marriage in this holy place, and all whose names will join theirs in the years to come. Kindle, O Lord, in our hearts, we pray, the flame of that love which never ceases, that it may burn in us and bring light to others. May we shine forever in your temple, set on fire with that eternal light, the light that puts to flight the darkness of this world. In the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. And now we join together in the words of the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And if any of you would like to join in the prayer, renewing your commitment to each other, please say together with me, Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of marriage. We rejoice in the blessings that it has brought us, and we ask for your forgiveness when our love has fallen short. Inspire us with your love and grace, and renew in us our love for one another. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Sir.
Will you please stand for the blessing? May God bless you and bless you kindly. Bless your relationships, your families and your friends. May you leave this holy place rejoicing in the love that surrounds you and strengthens you. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.